unity between them. Okay? So you might call these centering qualities of the church, unity and holiness. And again, I see them as more modality oriented. I think modalities are better at strengthening the church along these lines. So a little bit more on these same points. This is just kind of laying out in a different way what I've just said. We got these two dynamics of the kingdom and church. Maybe this wasn't totally obvious what I just said, but I see, like in the book of Acts and it throughout church history, there's this tendency for there to be expansion, but then there's also consolidation. There's expansion into new regions and new people groups, and then there's consolidation of those groups, making sure that they're really united with others and that they're holy, they're following also the apostolic teaching. And by the way, the apostolic I put on both under expansion and under consolidation. And I think that makes sense because the apostles' teaching is a consolidating, norm, but following the apostles means a dynamic thrust towards mission. All right? I know I'm going kind of quickly through this stuff, but if you have like a burning question along the way, I might let you quickly ask, but then we'll have some time at the end as well. Oh. One more thing, is I tend to connect expansion with the Great Commission and then consolidation with the Great Commandment. Being unified and holy are ways of loving one another as well. So, okay. All right. So we've seen, I think, that the functions that are implied by those four marks of the church in the Nicene Creed, that those functions, you could say, I argue, are best carried out by a kind of cooperative division of labor among modality and sodality structures, modality and sodality structures being part of the big picture of what the church is. And then by knowing the strengths and weaknesses of each of the two structures, we're positioned to embrace each of them and to see them function in mutual interdependence. In this way, the people of God are better positioned to fulfill both the Great Commandment and the Great Commission. And just a quick note in terms of history, I've already said this a little bit, but in the Middle Ages we see both of these kind of structures operating, especially with, you can see like Celtic monks going forth in mission, obviously as sodality initially as teams, that is not everybody in the church that's on one of these apostolic bands, but then what they're doing along the way is they're planting churches, and then those can nurture and consolidate what has been gained by the initial missional thrust. Okay, and then in Protestantism, although it really took a couple hundred years for Protestants to start emphasizing the sodality, like with William Carey and the missionary movement of the 1800s, there were groups like the Pietists and the Moravians that integrated and combined emphasis on modalities and sodalities very well. Now sometimes, it's almost like if you add like overlapping circles, the modalities and sodalities almost become one because you have such a high level of commitment that goes beyond a typical church, but it's actually everyone in the community that's a part of that. And that's what you see in the Moravians of groups like that. Well, we're running out of time, let's see.